Hi, I'm Neha Matthews, and you're listening to Three Things, the Indian Express news show. The budget for the fiscal year of 2020 to 2021 was announced on Saturday by Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman. It was a long speech, almost 2 hours 45 minutes long, and interspersed with plenty of poetry.
I fall back on the wise words of Thiruvalluvar. And this, it's very important, sir.
But within the long speech are details worth unpacking. With this budget, Nirmala Sitharaman had a hard task. The central government is dealing with an economy that is in the middle of a crisis, which is showing no signs of abating. On this episode, we look at whether the budget 2020 will help boost our economy. Udit Mishra, who writes on the economy for Indian Express, joins me to break down whether this budget will serve to help the economy both in the short and long term. Now, you've previously talked about GDP growth and how it relies on four factors for growth engines. And all of these engines have been flagging or struggling over the past few years. Could you tell us what these four engines are?
Right. So, I mean, it's a basic identity in macroeconomics that you could look at the GDP that a country gets from the demand side. You could break up the GDP into four drivers in the economy. One is the private consumption. That is what you and I as private individuals buy or consume, buying a movie ticket or eating a meal outside. And the second component is what the government spends, whatever it does. And the third component is what the private businesses invest, laying down a factory, starting a new business. So whatever investment that a private business does. And the fourth component is the net effect of exports and imports. So these are the four main drivers. And as I mentioned in the piece also, for a while now, private investments. Now, one thing to understand is that it's the consumption. In India's case, it's consumption, which is essentially the biggest component. It basically contributes 57 odd percent of the total demand. The business investments are around roughly 30 odd percent. Government is around 10, 11%, and the rest is the net exports. Now, the investments part had been sort of slowing down roughly from the start of 2011-12, and more sharply from 2013. And that was essentially because a lot of companies which had taken big bets in the preceding decade, thinking that, you know, the economy is doing great, people are demanding more, let's pump in investments and all this capacity will be sold. They got their bets wrong because of the global financial crisis. Many of them got stuck because halfway through the project, the money dried up, projects remained incomplete, and so it got into a mess. So those businesses never, frankly, recovered from that, and they could never invest anymore. So we found that the traditionally big companies that used to invest sort of just shut shop. That sort of put paid to that engine of growth. The new companies, you can always ask, why didn't they do it? Part of that reason was that the financiers to the economy, which were the banks, were also struggling from the other aspect, which was the non-performing assets. Now, these non-performing assets were in great part the same loans that they had given to these big businesses for the bets that never came off. And that sort of was the story on investments. Because of the global financial crisis, the global demand for goods and trade was in any case fairly feeble. And so exports really didn't help. And it also doesn't help that India was in any case never a big exporter. We've never really been a strong exporting nation. That's one of our major failings. So our domestic bottlenecks got exposed even more when the global demand for goods was weak. So that's the second engine, which was sort of faltering. So for the last 3-4 years, what we were seeing was that India was running on essentially what the government was spending and what you and I were essentially, people like us, consuming. But in the backdrop, you also have to see who, when we say you and I, it includes everybody from the rural areas, from the poorest to the urban areas, to youth. And if you look at the sectoral breakup of the economy every passing quarter, you'll find that over the 3-4 years, rural demand or rural incomes have got hurt because, you know, either there were droughts and their crops were destroyed, or 1 year there was demonetization. Even when you know, inflation happens, they don't generally get all the returns that are due to them. So the terms of trade were not favorable to them, and rural demand had been getting increasingly weak. And one key element that happened in last financial year, that is 18-19 in the third quarter, was the breakdown of the non-bank financial companies sector. Now, in the absence of those big banks which were not lending, the NBFCs had been lending for a lot of consumption loans. But because their viability also came into question, which is again a big topic we'll discuss separately, but because their viability also came into question, their loans to for private consumption stalled, and hence this weakness spread across both urban and rural areas. There has been, because of a slowing economy, fewer jobs, lesser income growth. So all of this basically meant that the consumption element, that engine, was getting weaker and weaker. And in the last 12 to 18 months, you can say that it has totally fallen off the radar. You know, it's just, and we've seen that in all kinds of data showing that this is not selling, that is not selling. That left the government engine. And the problem with the government engine is that government can spend either by the tax revenues it gets, which in turn are dependent on fast growth. If their growth is not happening, revenues will not happen. Or else it can borrow, but you can't borrow beyond a point because there are FRBM restrictions. If you break them, then inflation and interest rate can go up. So that's broadly the conundrum that Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman found herself, that, you know, frankly, there are no engines that are really coming to her rescue, and she had to pick and choose with very limited resources what to do.
What was expected from the government also, I think, like we discussed before, was more government spending, and we expected this to somehow also boost consumption. Could you explain what that link would have been?
Yeah, right. So see, typically when the government spends, suppose it spends on, it says, okay, we'll make a big road, then it employs people, pays them salaries. And so what the government spends, say 100 rupees on making a road, then that 100 rupees goes to those people who are trying to make the roads. It becomes their income. They instead, in turn, use that 100 rupees and go ahead and spend it on different things like a shampoo or a meal. And it becomes somebody else's income. So that is how the economic activity has been generated. Now, for a moment, if you were to think that the government decided not to build that bridge, then none of this economic activity would have happened. For a lot of people who were demanding government to spend, that was essentially the idea, that if the government was to spend, it was going to, even if it has to borrow money, let it borrow money and spend, because it can create activity. It can create economic activity. It can bring people back into a consumption cycle. Right now, people are holding back consumption. That was essentially the idea of how government spending could have triggered a consumption revival.
But in this sense, there's also, you know, certain hurdles that this government spending were facing, like you mentioned before. It wasn't, the odds weren't in their favor right now, right?
Exactly. Now, as I mentioned, because their revenues are short, I mean, this current financial year for which the data has now come in, their revenues were short by 3 lakh crores. That's a huge amount. And there are two problems, as I mentioned. One is that revenues cannot be sorted right in a hurry. For that, you must grow at a certain pace. Your tax revenues will come dependent on how the rest of the economy is growing, because those are the people who will actually pay taxes. The other thing is that, as this government has done, I mean, at least stipulated for the next financial year, is to raise funds through disinvestment. You have assets, you have PSUs, you have ownership in different institutions. You can sell your stake and get some money on the side and use that money to fund activity. So that's broadly the situation. So for next financial year, they have set themselves a very ambitious disinvestment target of 2.1 lakh crores. How unrealistic this could be, or at least sounds unrealistic, can be measured by the fact that last year, they raised only 66,000 crores from disinvestment. And that was per se not a bad number as such. I mean, historically, they have not raised too much money from disinvestment. So the government has been struggling with where to get the money from.
In all of this also, I mean, was there anything in the budget then that could boost? We can see boosting consumption, both in short term and long term.
So what the finance minister seems to have done is that within the limited resources that she had, she's tried to give people more disposable income and nudge them towards more consumption. What she basically wants is that people should have a little more money and spend that money. They should not save that money. A good example of that is the new income tax structure that she has provided, which is right now optional, where there are no deductions. Now, typically, these deductions and exemptions that we talk about are exemptions and deductions for different kinds of saving schemes. You know, you take a health insurance scheme, your taxable income comes down. You take a loan for your kids' education, your taxable income comes down, stuff like that. What she has done is that we will not give you any deductions or exemptions. We'll tax you at a lower rate. Now, where it may work for a lot of people is that a lot of people, maybe suppose I don't have a kid and I don't have a kid's education, I might want to shift to a lower rate of tax and in the process get higher disposable income and use that possibly to consume more, maybe buy that car that I was hoping to buy or go for maybe a couple of extra meals. I mean, for whatever. I mean, it's just a marker of pushing, nudging people towards higher consumption. So that has been basically the strategy towards consumption. And she's done a few other things, but those are more in terms of governance reforms, which is, again, not a bad thing, which is like clearing the cobwebs from the procedural matters, reducing the procedural matters, bringing down the compliance burden. That's broadly the strategy that she has employed.
And when it comes to, say, investment, I think we did see the government previously slash corporate tax rates. And back then you had talked about how this could be used either to increase investment or they could maybe use it to get rid of their existing debt. You know? Now, what are the sort of investment opportunities that we're seeing from the budget coming out?
So the corporate tax cut was one big thing, but since it had already been done, what she's done, a couple of things that were longstanding. One was the dividend distribution tax that has been removed, which was a longstanding demand. Don't tax when we give dividend. So that should help matters. The other thing is that she's brought in electricity generation within that fold who can avail the lower corporate tax structure that she had unveiled last year. And so broadly, she's just tweaked a few more things, but the big thing had happened last year for investments. And to be fair to her, investment will not pick up until unless businesses see that there is substantial amount of demand. They would not invest any more money. Coming back to the point that I mentioned about just making it easier in terms of compliance burden. So for many of the MSMEs, she's raised the turnover threshold where they need to get their books audited from, I think, 1 crore to 5 crore. So it's just making it easier for people to get on with their lives. Similarly, she's taken quite a few measures to make it easier for startups to function. So essentially, the idea is, listen, we cannot spend too much money right now. So we will try to do whatever we can in terms of maybe reducing the compliance burden and making procedures simpler. And she's also talked about, apart from faceless assessment of taxes, now there's going to be faceless appeal for such queries. So, you know, several such small but significant measures, which if they were implemented in right earnest, will help. There is no doubt about it. But whether they will be implemented or not, or whether this was just something to cover up from a budget, which otherwise didn't have too much to offer.
Something we'd heard before the budget also was, you know, please, no shocks in this budget. Would you say there were any surprises in this that you didn't anticipate?
I think the big announcement that seemed to have caught everybody by surprise was the announcement for LIC. Again, there have been some reports about LIC being put on the block, but nobody really believed that that bid eventually happened because LIC is also one institution, which is a mammoth institution, and it has a lot of money, which has been bailing out the government in different ways, you know. So for the government to let go of stake there, it seems a little odd. And frankly, a lot of people have also asked that now that if LIC was to come be presented, its books have to be opened for outside scrutiny. They'll have to clean up the books somewhere. There'll be question marks on what's happening behind the veil in LIC, where the money is going, where the money is coming from. So that, I think, was the surprising decision. The other thing was, again, the income tax structure. Again, there had been a long-standing demand that the government should cut income taxes, bring them more in line, simplify them. She hasn't exactly simplified them, But this new structure she has given, and the surprising element is the bit that while she's given you an option between the two structures, one without deductions and one with no deductions and lower rates, the coercive bit there is that once you go to the new structure, you can never get back. You cannot a year later say that, listen, this is not working for me. And frankly, I'm planning to buy a house and I would be better on the old structure and getting a deduction for my EMI for the loan that I took for my house. The government will not allow you to get back. So that is a bit of a coercive thing. And I don't know how many, I mean, if people are aware of that, they may not necessarily happily go to the new structure.
There's also been talk about how it has been, all in all, a sort of disappointing budget. There doesn't seem to be any sort of heavy lifting done to spur growth. Would you agree with that?
Yes, that's true. I mean, I think a lot of people saw this as a make or break budget because they thought that the intensity of the growth slowdown was quite sharp. And every passing quarter, we've been surprised by the downward shift. The government has been surprised. The observers have been surprised. And there was a genuine sense that maybe the government should abandon fiscal responsibility norms and stuff and basically roll up their sleeves and do the heavy lifting right now, spend money directly, and most probably spend it on capital investment, which actually has a huge multiplier effect. 100 rupees spent on capital building gives 200 rupees, generates 250 rupees in the economy instead of just paying more salaries, so which is the revenue account. Now, could the government have done that? Would that have solved things? Nobody can say for sure. We've seen that in 2008-09, when the global financial crisis had hit, the government had given a lot of sops, the fiscal deficit had gone up, and over the next 3-4 years, we saw huge inflation, double-digit inflation, and our macro stability really went for a toss. So it's maybe not such a great idea always to spend as if there is no tomorrow. But yes, it would have helped immensely if the government had, you know, got its fiscal house in order in the last few years. If it had got that cushion in terms of money, then today they would have been in a much better position to boost growth. And I think part of the problem is that they have been in denial for too long a time. They would not accept that things are going as bad as they are. Yesterday, if you see the budget documents, they mention the word temporary, that it's a temporary slowdown. So, I mean, there is a certain sense of denial that, you know, this is not something that may sustain. If it does, as it seems to be sustaining for long enough, the government doesn't have the revenues to survive, doesn't have the legs to stand on this. So government has to be better prepared. I mean, this whole episode has shown that the government has been found wanting in terms of preparedness.
You were listening to Three Things by the Indian Express. Today's show, as always, was edited and mixed by our producer, Joshua Thomas. If you like the show, then do subscribe to us wherever you get your podcasts. You can also recommend the show to someone you think will like it. Share with a friend or someone in your family. It's the best way for people to get to know about us. You can also tweet us at Express Audio and write to us at podcasts@indianexpress.com.